because this is the first time I'm presenting this paper. It's a little dense in terms of the detail, so I'm going to have to read parts of it, so please bear with me. Most of my work has been on rural and urban environmental conflicts in India, and what I'm presenting today is probably the last bit of work that I'll be doing on Delhi and on environmental conflicts in an urban area which is marked by profound inequality, great differences in terms of people's access to basic resources, and what I'm describing today is one particular aspect of that difference, namely access to green spaces. This lecture series is organized around the idea of the Anthropocene. So I was trying to find a way of linking my talk today with the challenges thrown up by the idea of the Anthropocene into the social sciences. And I think one of these challenges is that there's a difficulty that we face now of being able to maintain disciplinary boundaries and the attempt to start off new organizing fields such as that of environmental humanities is one way of trying to transcend the disciplinary divides that that proved to be so obstructive when we're dealing with something of the scale and complexity of the Anthropocene. The second thing that the Anthropocene idea forces us to re-examine is the separation between nature and culture, between humans and their habitats, that has been so much a sort of underlying principle of disciplinary knowledge across different areas. So how might we respond to these provocations? One, the challenge to revisit our disciplinary boundaries, and second, that of revisiting the separation between nature and culture. So what I'm going to do today is to set aside the disciplinary question for the moment and talk about the idea of socio-nature as a principle for examining how parks and urban publics are mutually constituted in Delhi. And social change has over time led to a reimagination of cultural meanings and modes of ecological management. But at the same time, ecological change in turn has created new meanings and social relations around the use and protection of nature. So I'm going to be talking about two particular places. One is Mangarbani, which is a sacred grove on the edge of the metropolis of Delhi. And the second, the Delhi Ridge, which is a so-called wilderness, which has been domesticated for recreational use and is now primarily used as a park. And I'm going to try and show you that the move to both create as well as preserve certain forms of urban nature is related to the shifting sensibilities of elites, especially that section which has appointed itself as the vanguard of environmental causes. However, the sort of far-reaching effects that these bourgeois environmentalists seek to bring about are challenged and undermined, as I'll show you, by other uses of public green areas. So the contested meanings and practices around natures in Delhi create new alliances and understandings that may promote ecology and justice. That's what I hope to show today. Now, the relation between nature and society has been a focus of attention in the social sciences and humanities since their very inception. In this talk, however, I'll follow only one thread of this complex skein of theories, starting with Raymond Williams's seminal essays, Ideas of Nature, which came out in 1972. Williams argued that nature was a cultural artifact. Not only was the natural world physically transformed by human actions, our very perception of the natural world was shaped by socially produced ideas and sentiments. Referring to this material and imaginative work, Williams wrote, and I quote, "We have mixed our labor with the earth, our forces with its forces too deeply to be able to separate each other out." And Raymond Williams' classic work, The Country and the City, shows how an urbanizing society with its historically varied experience of the Industrial Revolution came to change its view of rural life and the countryside, a shift that's reflected in the literature of that period. Williams's work precedes a more recent surge of writing in political ecology that tries to transcend dualistic conceptions of nature-society relations by tracking how nature is socially constructed and culturally produced in the past and the present. And I'm thinking here of the work of scholars like William Cronin, Richard Pete, Michael Watts, Noel Castry, and Bruce Brown. One strand of this research explores how cities and how their apparently artifactual character is in fact based on material and discursive transformations of nature. And this literature is also influenced by Bruno Latour's actor network theory, the notion that complex networks of human and non-human actors combine in hybrid forms that defy the nature-culture divide. While Latour's work pushes the boundaries of how social nature may be conceived, it tends to ignore the power relations that permeate such networks. As Williams says, if we say only that we have mixed our labor with the earth, our forces with its forces, we are stopping short of the truth that we have done this unequally. So understanding processes of social nature demands keeping in mind both social inequality as well as natural variability. And location matters, the cultural geography of class, caste, nation, and gender, and the materiality of biophysical processes in specific places are equally consequential. So studying environmental conflict and collective action requires relating human actors and their habitus to habitats that alter and exert power. So my talk today approaches the contentions around Delhi's green spaces from this analytical perspective. So let me take you to the first place I'm going to talk about, which is Magarbani. Nothing quite prepares you for the first view of Magarbani. There's the Gurgaon Faridabad toll road, your sort of standard highway on Delhi's outskirts, rolling through a landscape where dusty scrub vegetation is being rapidly replaced by dustier high-rise construction sites. There's an eyesore called the Gurgaon Faridabad Combined Solid Waste Management Facility, acres of open garbage through which forage scrawny cows and flapping crows. Besides the unpaved road along the dump's broken boundary wall, there are deep jagged edge craters, relic from the stone quarrying that happened here until 15 years ago. The land is rocky and open, dotted about with trees and shrubs, one of those ennui-inducing views where your mind begins to wander to more interesting things like the grocery shopping list or reminding yourself to call the plumber when you get home. But in the middle of this nowhere, naturalist Pradeep Krishan, author of the guidebook Trees of Delhi, who I'm accompanying, stops the car. We walk for about 10 minutes, winding our way past rocks hugged by stunted plants, between trees twisted by hot, dry winds. It's only 8 o'clock on a morning in late March, but it feels like summer. And then suddenly, we arrive at the lip of a cliff. The ground drops away, and so does my jaw, because spread out below us is a deep, wooded valley, densely and delicately green, the expanse of its tree canopy broken only by the whitewashed dome tower of a small shrine in the distance. Besides the shrine, the only other sign of human presence is a boundary pillar at the far end of the valley. That's it. The rest is undisturbed forest. The only sound is a plaintive call of peafowl, the only movement their ponderous glide from one tree to another. Now and then the silence is punctuated by the racket of parakeets arrowing across the sky. A gust of breeze briefly ruffles the grasses by the outcrop of rocks below our feet. Everything else is still. We could be 200 kilometers away in the middle of Sariska National Park, except that we are not. We're in the Delhi National Capital Region, 20 minutes away from wall-to-wall carpeting of tarmac, glass, concrete, stone, 20 minutes from traffic jams, crowds, noise, dust, and smoke. And yet it feels like we've landed on a different planet. What's so special about Magarbani? It's not as if Delhi lacks large green spaces. Besides numerous parks and gardens, there's a densely wooded expanse of what's called the ridge, the northernmost spur of the Aravali mountain range, which stretches all the way to the state of Rajasthan. However, from the ecological point of view, the ridge is seriously compromised. A lot of it has been spruced up for human use, the undergrowth cleared and exotic species planted. Among these imports, the most pernicious has been a tree called Vilaiti Kikar, or Prosopis juliflora, imported from Mexico, which has established itself by suppressing indigenous plant species and the life forms that they support. In the slide on top, you can see the naturalist Pradeep Krishan, who takes guided walks through of people who are interested in trees and nature through the Mangalwadi forest. Because the tree that you see below, Prosopis juliflora, is very hardy and it propagates easily, it's been a favorite of forest departments looking for a quick fix for greening India since colonial times. So in most large green areas in Delhi and its environs today, juliflora is an invasive alien species, dominating over native flora to the detriment of local biodiversity. However, Mangalwadi has remained remarkably free of the Vilaiti Kikar curse. Even more miraculously, it has undergone virtually no human interference or exploitation for several hundred years. The surrounding villages have protected the grove as sacred to the memory of Gudariya Baba, a hermit whose shrine stands at the base of the valley. They believe that anyone who cuts wood or grazes their animals in this 100-hectare forest invites the Baba's wrath and retribution. So Mangalwadi stands out in the Delhi region for being an unspoiled old growth forest of a kind unique to the Aravalli range, a startling vision of what these ancient hills would look like if they were protected from biotic pressure. And what a vision it is, because the top of the valley and its steep sides are thickly coated with thau, Anogyasis pendula, a medium-sized tree with delicate leaves that go from pale green to purple brown. Such a profusion of thau is typical of the climax vegetation of some tropical dry deciduous forests. According to Krishan, whose book brought Mangalwadi to the notice of wider public, the tree used to be found all over the ridge, but is now in danger of disappearing in Delhi. Two other trees found in such forests that have vanished from the ridge, Kalasiris and Salai with its fragrant resin, survive only in Mangalwadi in the Delhi region. The valley includes some dry and sandy patches where plants typical of arid regions can be found, but in the moist valley floor is shadowed by tall kerm and kanju trees. Kanju has seeds encased in translucent papery discs. And in this season, Dudhi Ki Bel, or Valeris, is laden with sweet-smelling creamy flowers. Their perfume escorts us down to Gudariya Baba's shrine. On the path to the shrine, however, there's a nasty surprise, because there's a temple, a large building with a courtyard and pond, which is being expanded to double its size. The land has already been cleared of its vegetation. The temple is now the site of an annual fair and other religious events, and the crowds that descended on it most recently have left behind smelly heaps of dry and dirty styrofoam plates. There's other creative sculpture happening around the temple. And as you go around, we notice that although the temple's growing precincts pose a problem in this pristine area, there's an even bigger issue at stake, one that threatens the very existence of Mangalwadi. So this is now some complicated land history, so I'll try and make it as clear as possible. Mangalwadi and its surrounding land used to be what's called the Shamila Day, or the commons of three villages. And these were villages dominated by the Gujjar caste, a caste of mainly pastoralists who also took to settled agriculture. These are about 3,000 landowning households. Since pre-colonial times, only the landowners constituted the proprietary body of the village, the Malikan Dey, and only they got to sit in the village council. So people who were landless weren't a part of the traditional panchayats or local councils. And it's the landlords, the owners, who control the forest, grazing lands and ponds. In revenue records, these commons were classified as uncultivable, and therefore they were exempt from agricultural tax. So landless households, the service castes, the others in the village, including those who belonged to the scheduled castes, the former untouchable castes, had rights to collect firewood and fodder from these commons only at the pleasure of the upper caste landowning patrons, and as did their agricultural tenants. So in the 1970s, late in the 1970s, the government began a program of what they call land redistribution. So they took the commons and started allocating plots of the land to landless scheduled caste households for cultivation. And this was a relatively painless program of land reform, since it didn't expropriate any existing landowner of their cultivable land, only allocated a portion of their shared uncultivable commons. However, the landowners were not willing to allow even this limited curtailment of their rights, and they managed to successfully block it. Afraid that the government would once again try to wrest control of their commons, landowning villagers across Haryana state mobilized, and they managed to make sure that instead of being collectively owned by the village panchayat or the council, the commons came to be partitioned, such that individual owners of agricultural land received titles in common lands in proportion to the size of their private holdings. So if you had 100 acres, you got 10%. If you had 50 acres, you got 5% of the commons and so on. And this partition, however, remained notional until 1986, when individual claims began to be actually demarcated on the ground. And this privatization of the commons then facilitated their commodification. So several villagers sold their titles to the commons to real estate developers and speculators, who then went on to fence and wall in these plots, preparatory to clearing and building on them. This activity is so far confined to the area surrounding Mangalbani, but may soon encroach into the forest if the real estate lobby in Haryana government has its way. Many individual titles have been sold and resold to what's been called by a government bureaucrat as a powerful business, politico-bureaucratic police nexus with ostensibly no interest in agricultural activities. So the actors who collaborate in this nexus include influential local men who persuade their fellow villagers to sell their land. Some of them have set up small offices along the main road advertising their business as property brokers. They get financial backing and enforcement muscle from local politicians who bribe and intimidate lower level officials to legitimize and expedite transactions. Bigger real estate firms either buy land through these brokers or appoint them as their agents on the ground, getting capital from investors who include not only people seeking homes and offices for their own use, but also speculators looking to gain from the rise in property prices. For owners of unaccounted wealth, real estate in India, with this large gap between the declared and actual value of property and its undocumented cash transactions, is a convenient way to invest black money. Corrupt politicians and bureaucrats are an essential part of this real estate economy, and they help developers negotiate the regulatory hurdles required to secure building permissions in return for a share of the profits. The glue of kinship holds this tight-knit network together, so several leading politicians have immediate relatives in the real estate business. It is this political economy of land transactions and the land transformation extending from the village to the state's topmost leaders that led in 2011 to a draft development plan for Mangar being prepared, which zoned the entire forest for commercial and residential use, a designation that is a death sentence for Mangar. From 1991, developers started using an act called the Consolidation Act, which was meant to redress the fragmentation of agricultural fields and village commons by letting people reorganize and pool together their land. But it's been used by developers to accumulate land holdings in violation of the Land Sealing Act. And since many of these holdings are under fictitious names, it's difficult to track and prosecute the actual owners. With the help of political leaders, corrupt revenue department officials, land brokers, and complicit villagers, Mangalbani is on the verge of going the same way as the rest of the Arabi landscape, denuded, buried under concrete, and ancient forest gone forever. One would think that it requires a sea change in values for villagers who have protected Mangalbani for centuries to now be willing to see it destroyed. But this change didn't happen overnight. Quartzite quarrying in the Aravalli Hills in Delhi, Haryana, and Rajasthan picked up speed in the 1980s when Delhi underwent a construction boom before the Asian Games of 1982. Mining struck deeper and wider over the next 2 decades as the National Capital Region witnessed unprecedented growth. Some quarries were on private lands, but most were on village commons, and village council leaders were quick to seize the chance to make money, even though farmers reported that the blasting and removal of rocks was affecting groundwater. In places, the landscape was visibly altered, with entire hills gouged out over the course of months. It was only in 2002 that, acting on a public interest petition, the Supreme Court ordered a ban on mining in the entire Aravalli range. However, by this time, farming and livestock rearing in the semi-arid terrain were already dwindling as remunerative livelihoods. Once the money from mining stopped, villagers were left high and dry and altogether willing to consider other options for their land. The Mangalbani forest, however, remained intact over the last 3 decades, even as the surrounding landscape and people's relationships to land were changing rapidly. What tipped the scales against the collective protection of Mangalbani as a sacred grove was a tide of real estate development sweeping in from Gurgaon and Faridabad, these two satellite towns which were planned as magnets to reduce congestion in Delhi, and that were unencumbered by the Urban Land Ceiling Act that prohibited private firms from undertaking large-scale projects in the capital city. And so these two towns, Faridabad and Gurgaon, offered rich pickings for real estate developers. Selling to developers made many landowners cash rich beyond their imagination. Farming was a subsistence activity at best, so these villagers were only too willing to give it up. Land in the area around Mangalbani remained low value till about 6 years ago, when the road connecting Gurgaon and Faridabad was upgraded in anticipation of the eventual merging of the boundaries of these two expanding cities. The villagers in this area who sold their lands, including their claim to the Mangalbani forest, were only doing what most of Haryana's villagers have done or are waiting to do. But what are the religious significance of Mangalbani? How could Gurariya Baba's prohibition be defied? When asked about this, some villagers reiterated their commitment to him. They said, "The Baba said that no one will cut wood or graze animals here. We've been abiding by his words for ages," said Jairam Harsana of Mangar village. He also described what happened to those who violated the Baba's injunction: livestock dying, wooden beams in houses bursting into flame. But by selling his title to the forest, he is at a remove from those acts of retribution, since he will not be the one actually cutting the trees. He has regrets, though, about selling the sacred grove, and in 2011 signed a petition along with other elderly villagers asking the government to protect the forest. When asked how that would affect the rights of those who had purchased the titles to Mangalbani's land intending to develop it, he expressed his helplessness. "It was 30 years ago," he said. "We didn't know. It was only on paper. No one knew who owned which piece of land. We didn't think it would come to this," unquote. If there's regret in some quarters about losing the forest, other villagers seem to be taking Gurariya Baba's legacy in a different direction altogether. Near the Baba's simple whitewashed shrine is a newly built temple, painted standout saffron and all set to expand its precincts, adding area as well as deities to the Shiva-led pantheon currently installed for worship. With the temple attracting more devotees and visitors, Mangalbani spiritual center seems to be shifting away from Gurariya Baba to the standard Hindu multi-god, multi-purpose buffet, bringing a commercial element which was earlier absent from the forest. The temple is both a salve to the conscience that rues selling out the Baba — people say we're improving this religious place — and a sign that the Baba's spirit may soon be superseded by the all too familiar process of temple-led land grab. Perhaps villagers would have had a clearer consensus about protecting Mangalbani if the forest had remained a commons. If individual titles had not been allotted to landowners, it would have been harder to sell the undivided land. But this is speculation. What is evident is that although the village no longer functions as a collective body in deciding the fate of the forest, another collective entity has stepped in to save Mangalbani. A group of environmentalists, most of them upper middle class residents of Gurgaon with an interest in water conservation, started a campaign by publicizing Mangalbani's ecological richness and calling upon the government to fulfill its environmental mandate. The campaigners point out that changing land use here would violate a Supreme Court order that densely wooded areas, regardless of ownership, be legally notified as forests and protected accordingly. They demand that the draft development plan of Mangal, which zones the area for residential and commercial use, be scrapped. After a lot of back and forth and some, you know, the government constantly trying to make sure that the area could be kept as a commercial area for development, the Save Mangal Mani campaign has been successful in finally getting the government to demarcate the area as a conservation zone. And they're trying to make sure that the degraded forest around Mangal Mani is also then protected as a buffer, which will mean that the catchment area in this the catchment of several streams in this area is also protected, helping to improve what has been a plummeting aquifer. So, although I'll end the Mangal Mani story by saying that the conservationists still need to keep up their pressure on the government, because periodically there are reports of fully grown trees being cut in the area at night and so on. And they have mainly been working through the courts and the media to make sure that the law, that the legal protection that Mangal Mani has is actually translated into practice. Now, although Mangal Mani is in some ways a special case, a sacred grove on the periphery of a modern metropolis, it highlights the processes through which urban India loses and acquires green spaces, the political economy of land ownership and use. It also delineates the social transformations that reconfigure the cultural meanings that inhere in green spaces. The Mangal Mani forest came out of obscurity in the last decade because it featured in the handbook of a naturalist who also guided walks in the area. The weekend visitors it attracted were wilderness lovers, affluent residents of Delhi and Gurgaon, many of whom became homeowners thanks to real estate development facilitated by the political bureaucratic nexus that took over village lands. Now that this process threatens Mangal Mani, in an ironic twist, some of the beneficiaries of land commodification have become environmentalists and have ranged themselves against the builder mafia, from whom they bought their luxury apartments and bungalows, seeking to protect a green space that not only that is not only perceived to be ecologically valuable, but also an enhancement of their quality of life. From a mutually advantageous relationship with builders, sections of the elite have shifted their allegiance to a new axis, aligning with the older generation of Mangar villagers. Thus, even though as the corporate identity and power of the village is broken down into individual fragments that hasten the commodification of land, another collective group constitutes itself as the guardian of the forest. The environmentalists don't replace the villagers, nor are they in conflict with all of them. In fact, by talking to villagers about the biodiversity of the forest, reminding them that it is their protection that has sustained this grove over the centuries, the environmentalists hope to revive a collective sentiment that will enable them to fight together for the future of Mangal Mani. Even as the Baba's spiritual hold on the villagers seems to be eroding, environmentalists have stepped in with ecological arguments about respecting all life forms, the interconnectedness of trees, soil, water and air, living in harmony with nature, arguments that at times resemble a secular religion. So moving now to the Delhi Ridge. The sensibility that underlies the environmentalist efforts, their appreciation of Mangal Mani as an original ecological place worthy of protection, is both modern and recent. Although many of the cities have flourished at the site of present-day Delhi over the last two millennia, had established systems to harness water and source timber and fuel from the hinterland, and had also designated land use based on topography and soil, they did not set aside any area for its ecological importance. Delhi's two main natural features, the river Yamuna, which you can see to the right of that picture, and the hilly ridge, the green areas that run like a central spine through the city. These two natural features went virtually ignored until the 1970s, even though they together defined the catchment that watered the wells and ponds crucial for the city's existence. The idea that these landscapes are valuable and worthy of special attention emerged only when Delhi's expansion had decimated them or severely damaged their ecological integrity. Ironically, as is often the case, the champions of these beleaguered urban ecologies emerged from the very middle classes that were the beneficiaries of urban growth. That is to say that the changing ridge and the burgeoning middle classes evolved together, each giving shape to the other. The ridge is a colonial term for an area known locally as Pahari or hilly land, a series of undulations that begin close to the river in North Delhi and stretch to the southwest, increasingly distant from the river. Images from the 19th century, this is from soon after 1857 during the First War of Independence against the British. These images show, so you can see the river Yamuna here on the left, that's the main city, the walled city of Shahjahanabad, and in the distance you can see the hills that are today called the ridge. And these show the ridge as an open, unpopulated wilderness with barely a tree in sight. It's likely that this was a matter of perspective, because British and Indian eyes would have passed over the thorny scrub forest as a wasteland because it lacked useful or imposing trees. The ridge may also have been laid bare over the years as trees were cut to provide city dwellers with fuel, the land grazed by livestock. However, its barren contours were to turn green in the next century. When New Delhi, the imperial capital, was being built between 1911 and 1931, at the foot of what is now known as the Central Ridge, and here you can see the first, the Delhi Planning Committee with what were to become the main architects of New Delhi, Edward Lutyens and Herbert Baker. This is where they were doing their surveys of planning where to build Delhi. When these guys were surveying the area, the Viceroy, Lord Harding, took a keen interest in where the city would be sited. And he initiated plans for extensive afforestation, imagining a dense evergreen curtain behind what he said would be a splendid government house placed at the top of Raisina Hill, and I quote, commanding the most lovely views of the city of Delhi and over the whole plain, dominating the whole country around, while the slope down the plain would be covered with terraces and fountains like a miniature Versailles. And in many ways, the British did succeed over the next 20 years in realizing this vision of imperial splendor and order. And along with these, the famous Mughal gardens that are a part of the Viceroy's house, now called the Rashtrapati Bhavan, where the President of India lives, in the far distance, what you can see is what is now the ridge. And what is generally not known is that the British are responsible not only for creating these extremely manicured and formal gardens, which sort of, you know, which is their way of symbolizing their power and transforming the landscape of India, but also the wilderness that lies behind. This is not some sort of, you know, native indigenous forest, but this is also a creation of colonial enterprise. The forest was important because it sort of fitted the threefold scheme of the English country mansion. That first you have formal gardens, then you have rolling lawns or a park, you know, a sort of pastoral place where you might have sheep nibbling away at the turf. And in the distance, the woods. The woods were used both for as utility forests for gathering fuel and so on, but also for riding, so for recreation. So this idea of formal gardens, a park, and a wood is what is also represented in miniature in the way in which New Delhi was designed, and this continues to this day. However, in creating this arboreal backdrop for the principal seat of imperial government, Harding drew upon the expertise of a forester called P.H. Clutterbuck. And Clutterbuck said that there are several dry indigenous, indigenous trees from the drier part of the Himalayan foothills, an area that he was an expert in, that he thought could be used to plant up the barren slopes of the ridge. And interestingly, the first secretary of Delhi, who was also in charge of these early experimental plantings, Haley, also said that I don't want exotics to be planted. They should only come after we've established indigenous trees. So another little bit of surprise for me, because I had expected that it's the British who would bring in the indigenous tree, who would bring in the exotics, and popularize them. But interestingly, their first impulse was to actually stick to indigenous species. And so planting proceeded slowly and on a small scale, limited by water and budget constraints. But the results weren't satisfactory. Trees died off as soon as watering was stopped. Few species could withstand the rigors of the ridge, its thin soils and exposure to extreme summer and winter temperatures. Because even though they wanted to grow indigenous trees, the trees that they chose were actually from far moister places in the Indo-Gangetic Plain. So those trees weren't, they should have actually looked for other Indian trees from Rajasthan, from the semi-arid hilly regions, rather than what they did. But over the next 20 years, the government struggled with planting indigenous trees, but although some survived, by and large, it was one exotic, namely Prosopis juliflora, that proved to be the most tenacious. It was hardy and drought resisting, it formed an evergreen vegetation, and trees raised from seed were quick to develop and extend into fresh ground and spread quickly. And this exotic had a strong champion in William Mustow, who was director of horticulture at that time, who would go around the hills and personally tuck individual seedlings into the ground on Sundays. And Mustow's diligence and Prosopis juliflora's persistence have left this lasting legacy, that the tree is now an invasive species crowding out the natives, and it now rules the ridge just as it does much of India's drylands, be it in the state of Gujarat or Tamil Nadu. Wherever you go, you will find Prosopis juliflora as a dominant species. Although the ridge was designated as a reserve forest, the legal status didn't in fact offer it watertight protection. And whenever land was needed for other purposes, portions of the woody ridge were made available. When the city expanded westwards, the central part of the ridge was cut in order to resettle the so-called untouchable and depressed castes from the congested walled city. After partition in 1947, when 500,000 Hindu and Sikh refugees came into Delhi, a large part to the of the central and southern ridge was cleared in order to resettle them and to set up new housing estates. The southern ridge was eaten into to set up new academic establishments like the Jawaharlal Nehru University and other institutional areas. Along the way, the hilly spine of the central ridge was partly taken over by the army, which has a polo ground and residential quarters there. And a major chunk was grabbed in the 1980s by the ashram of a popular saint called Asaram Bapu, who's now in jail for rape. But his ashram still holds onto that space. So all of these encroachments of the last 30 years have nibbled away the ridge until its death by a thousand cuts seemed imminent. What's happened is that not only has the forested area of the ridge shrunk because of land diversion and encroachment, from the 1980s the character of the forest has also begun to change. Until then, the wooded ridge was regarded as a wilderness and duly ignored. It was not trespassed upon except by poor women and men who collected wood for cooking and heating, and they would cajole or bribe the occasional chowkidar or guard to look the other way. In 1978, however, the central ridge was the scene of a gruesome crime, filed in popular memory as the Billa Ranga case. Geeta and Sanjay Chopra, whose photos you see down below, the teenage daughter and son of a naval officer, were abducted when they hitched a ride on the ridge road. The car was driven into the woods. Geeta Chopra was raped. She and her brother were murdered. The incident shook middle-class newspaper reading Delhi. Geeta and Sanjay could have been their children. As the hunt for the culprits began, the ridge came into focus as a place of danger, the locus of criminal activities. Efforts to bring law and order to the ridge took a physical form. From being an overlooked, overgrown space, the unruly ridge was to be disciplined. On the northern ridge, the domestication of wilderness took the form of clearing the dense understory of shrubs and creepers and replacing it with grass. Ornamental plants and shrubs were planted in neat beds, gravel walking paths were cut through the forest, a small pond was spanned by a bridge, reeds planted along its banks, and benches placed so that visitors could enjoy the pretty scene. A badminton court was created in Depression near the Flagstaff Tower built by the British in 1828, and the ridge was now accessible and inviting to middle-class citizens. Once manicured, sections of the ridge were enthusiastically incorporated into the social geography of residents or well-to-do neighborhoods in the area. Morning walks, the quintessential quotidian practice of urban Indians with sedentary lifestyles, bring cars to the gate of the ridge, from which middle-aged men and some women alight, all wearing the sports shoes that declare their commitment to their fitness regime. They stride briskly along the paths, swinging their arms, breathing deeply to fill their lungs with the clean morning air. Some stop to stretch, a few jog, groups do yoga and laughter therapy. Others carry packets of grain which they scatter at designated spots to feed flocks of parakeet and pigeons. Still others buy bananas to feed the rhesus monkeys that infest the ridge, the animals proliferating thanks to Hindus who revere them as an incarnate form of the god Hanuman. After their vigorous exercise, many morning walkers head for the fruit vendors outside to drink coconut water and eat papaya and other nutritious fruit. Then they get back into their cars and drive home to bathe and start the working day. While the crowds of morning walkers attest to the success of the project of taming the ridge and incorporating it into the ordered realm of urban rhythms, a different facet of this accessibility becomes apparent later in the day. By late morning, well, after the fitness enthusiasts have departed, the rows of parked cars outside the gates are replaced by motorcycles. Walking up the now deserted paths, one only encounters hopeful families of monkeys looking for handouts. But on the lawns, under shady trees and behind sheltering shrubs, there's a discreet but nonetheless palpable buzz of activity. Each semi-concealed spot offers some privacy, harbors a pair of young lovers looking for solitude. In a city where young women are subject to family surveillance and escaping the censorious public eye is difficult for romantic couples, the gardens of the ridge offer refuge. As Radhika Chandramani writes, there's safety in the park. The park sets limits. They hold hands, press palms together, play with each other's fingers. Privacy lurks in public spaces. Pleasure lies in the palm of a hand. Unquote. Paradoxically, the public park, where visibility is coupled with anonymity, allows a retreat from the public into a realm of privacy for partners of various sexual persuasions. Rendering the ridge safer for citizens by converting the forest into a wooded park created a space that enables romantic and sexual practices that would otherwise have been stifled. It allows youth to express themselves as lovers, desiring and desired subjects who can more fully participate in the increasingly influential discourse of romantic love and courtship. The domestication of the ridge thus not only creates new bourgeois forms of recreation and caring for the self, but also enables romantic and sexual practices in public spaces, pushing against the limits of what is considered culturally tolerable and gradually widening them. Making the ridge safer for ordinary and elite citizens had another unintended effect. Some of those who came to the park for morning walks were drawn to the area that was still wilderness. Sanjeev Khanna remembers when his dog darted into the undergrowth, chasing a grey francolin or some exciting scent. He said, when I followed him, pushing through the bushes, I found myself alone. It was really gorgeous, wild. Other people wouldn't go into this part of the ridge, but I loved it. Khanna was a teenager in the 1970s when he literally stumbled into a fascination for the wilderness of the ridge. And he later met a few other school and college students who were interested in bird watching, and he began to go on nature rambles with them, learning about the flora and fauna of the ridge and coming to understand the ecological importance of the forest. In 1979, when they read that a section of the central ridge was going to be demarcated for constructing schools, all these young students organized a protest rally in which they joined the residents of that neighborhood and of the proposed clearance, and they then went on to form an environmental action group called Kalpvriksh that campaigned against the diversion of the forest to other land use and the conversion of wilderness into parks. So over time, Kalpvriksh as a nature group has been successful in getting the government to set up a ridge management board in 1995. And now there's a large number of people, a number of other organizations, as well as individuals that focus on trying to protect the ridge. It's the physical experience of the ridge, which has for Kalpvruksh that's been a defining moment in the biography of the organization, when Khanna and others realized that it was the wilderness that they loved, not parks. How this sensibility set them apart from other upper middle class people, etc., is something I want to go into right now. But I just want to say that central to this critique of development and urbanization that environmental organizations like Kalpvruksh have is the sensual experience of the ridge in the early morning, its tangled wildness in contrast to the ordered populated park. I see that I don't have very much time left, so I'm not going to go into more details about the way in which the ridge has faced new threats as well as recruited new champions, other than to say that, you know, there are these interesting shifts in what has come to be, that in the 1990s, for instance, a lot of the ridge was cleared to create these affluent neighborhoods. And this, it's the residents of those affluent neighborhoods that today have become who are at the forefront of trying to conserve the bits of the ridge that are left, much as has been the case with Gurgaon and the residents there trying to protect Mangarbani. As Mangarbani and the Delhi ridge change and are threatened with change, they bring into being new allegiances and alliances. These green spaces of the urban publics who cohere around them have shaped and transformed each other. Reconfigured relations in the ecological and social landscape have had uneven effects. The domestication of the wilderness of the Northern Ridge for recreational use has squeezed out the native flora and fauna. Jackals, hares and monitor lizards have now disappeared. Poor people who collected firewood and grass find it much harder to do so because their vigilant middle class walkers and patrolling guards who are quick to pounce on them. The ridge is now also closed off as an urban common that provisions people who live by the sweat of their brow. They have been replaced by those who sweat in order to keep their bodies fit. Yet the concerns of the laboring classes have not figured in the debate on urban conservation. In other parts of the city, the conflict over urban nature has been even more violent. Early, Early one morning in January 1995, residents of the well-to-do neighborhood of Ashok Vihar caught and beat a young man called Dilip to death for defecating in the open area that they regarded as their park. The opposition between different views of urban nature and its commons could not be starker. Dilip was from an adjoining squatter settlement where more than 10,000 households had only 24 toilets between them, forcing people to use any open space under cover of dark as a place to defecate. The affluent residents of the area tried to foil this by building a wall between their settlement and their own homes, but soon the wall was broken to allow the daily traffic of domestic workers who lived in the squatter settlement but worked in the mansions of the rich. Dilip's death was thus the culmination of a long-standing battle over a contested space that to one set of residents embodied their sense of gracious urban living, a place of trees and grass devoted to leisure and recreation, and that to another set of residents was the only available space that could be used as a toilet. When a group of people from the squatter settlement gathered to protest against this killing, the police opened fire and killed four more people. The social geography of urban nature in Delhi is a deeply riven, shifting landscape. As the villagers of Mangarbani showed by their alacrity to sell their share of a sacred forest, green spaces can become taken for granted and traded for more tangible gains. Yet other social groups have intervened to evoke a sense of loss and a renewed appreciation of the forest, leading to a new determination to save it from developers. The domesticated sections of the Delhi Ridge now accommodate morning walkers and trysting couples, members of the middle-aged middle classes, as well as their subversive offspring. And at the same time, for a handful of people, the park opened up a path into the wilderness as an aesthetically and ecologically superior form of urban nature. While these are unexpected twists produced by the coming together of disparate elements and contingencies, there are expected patterns and continuities as well. More than 60 years after independence, Viceroy Lord Hardinge's urban forests command the higher ground close to the centers of power. The Versailles-style gardens that he envisaged grace affluent parts of the city. Greenery is a good index of a neighborhood's prestige and wealth. Its lack a sign of social exclusion and impoverishment. Most poor working class areas of Delhi are massed boxes of brick and cement broken only by narrow streets. There are no trees to sit under, no grass on which to run or play or take a nap in the winter sun. The government's proud slogan of clean and green city fades away once one leaves elite and middle class areas. When green is confined to the solitary tree that has survived in a wasteland or densely packed settlement, or the tulsi or sacred basil plant growing in a recycled tin, urban nature is conspicuous by its absence. As Mahatma Gandhi observes, the production of urban nature is a simultaneous process of social and biophysical change in which new kinds of spaces are created and destroyed. Unquote. To do justice to this process, we need analyses that place greater emphasis on the malleable, indeterminate, and historically specific dimensions to the urban experience. Malleable yet persistent, indeterminate yet structured, green spaces in Delhi, parks, wilderness, and wasteland are deeply streaked by social character, by ways of knowing and valuing nature that reflect the city's sharp hierarchies and shifting alliances. Thank you. Gosh, this was a really long paper, so thank you for listening so patiently.
We have time for questions.
I just have a simple one for you. Very, very much enjoyed the talk, quite illuminating. You talked at the beginning about the interdisciplinarity. I was just wondering, does any ethnography go into this? The question being, what points of view did you actually explore from the perspective of talking to different sides, in, for example, the developer side versus the villagers versus the wealthy residents in the high-rise and so forth? Did you actually have the opportunity to engage all the sides in these cases?
Not all, but much of what I talk about, the groups I talk about in this paper, namely the sort of bourgeois environmentalists who have banded together to try and protect the sacred grove, the villagers of Mangal who are now, some of them are now working with developers, others regret that they sold their land, and the environmental conservation group that I talked about later, Kalpavriksh. But also the people who use the ridge for recreational, and the morning walkers and so on. These are all groups that I have accompanied, spent time with, talked to, and much of the work on slums builds upon my previous work in Delhi, which has been concentrated on three squatter settlements, which I've looked at from the point of view of the larger transformation of Delhi's landscapes and what that's meant for the livelihoods of people who live in squatter settlements, especially migrants. I've been less successful in spending time with the developers, especially the large, the large companies which are doing the construction of the high rises and so on. So in some ways, this is a kind of a partisan ethnography. I should also say that the group that I talked about, Kalpavriksh, is a part of my own biography, because from 1980 onwards, I was also a part of this group that went for nature walks in the ridge and that then came together to try and protect the area and so on. So I try to be sort of, self-consciously critical of that experience. But in a way, writing this paper is also a way for me to review my own understandings of nature at that time and the ways in which those sensibilities were shaped by my own social location as, a person from an upper middle class background in Delhi. So initially, for instance, in Kalpavriksh, we never even noticed that there were poor women who were going in there every day and coming out with, bundles of firewood. We just thought women use firewood in rural areas. It was only when I grew up and, developed an insight into political ecology that I started paying attention to what the numbers of different things that were going on in the ridge. So it's ethnography, but part of it is also Just
follow up, not a question, but one of our graduates not that many years back was a professor at Rochester. Lorena Searle actually worked with the developers and
I know her work.
You know her work, okay, yes.
And it's very
so then she could probably help in terms of giving another point of view.
In the longer paper, I actually cite her work.
I see, okay.
Yeah, because it's very useful for providing that perspective of the developers and so on.
Right.
The other scholar I cite is Michael Levien at Johns Hopkins, who's done a book that's just about to come out on the takeover of agricultural land and village lands for these new commercial projects. And he's done it, you know, not in Delhi, but in the state of Rajasthan, but many of his conclusions apply also to Delhi. And he's very good at elaborating the processes by which the transactions unfold from the village up to the very highest levels of government.
Thank you.
Yes? Yes?
I enjoyed your talk very much. Thank you for the talk. I was wondering, two questions. One is when you mentioned this, the Mexican juniper, you seem to use indigenous and exotic as if they were self-explanatory, whereas there's a lot of, I mean, why is something from Rajasthan any more indigenous to Delhi than Mexico? I mean, what is the scale of indigeneity? This is something that is discussed in botanical literature. So I was wondering if you could reflect on that a little. Other question was also that you initially in your story you mentioned the emergence of the bureaucratic the kind of developer nexus, so the state kind of collaborating to make this happen. But on the other hand, how far is this, the new environmental politics, how far is that being aided or at least partially led by the emergence of things like public interest litigations, which are also like a state machinery, which again are used quite regularly by these environmental groups?
Yeah, thanks. Those are great questions. I mean, and in the longer paper, I talk about them a little bit, so I'm happy to get a chance to get into that right now. This question about, you know, what's indigenous and what's exotic is very, very critical to the way into, and it's part of an evolving conversation in India. So, you know, as I'm sure everybody here knows, South Asia has had a whole set, has had plant exchanges for millennia. And a number of those plants have in fact become naturalized. So a tree that Indians regard as quintessentially Indian, the neem tree, Azadirachta indica, is in fact not from the Indian subcontinent. It comes from Southeast Asia, from Burma. But you know, people plant it everywhere and think of it as an indigenous tree. So there's no doubt that there's a whole history of biodiversity movements from one continent to the other. And so sometimes some of these labels can be problematic. But I think there is now considerable evidence around the concept of what I call IAS, not the Indian Administrative Service, but invasive alien species. And right now in contemporary India, for very large parts, we can hold Proserpis juliflora, and I think now I would include Lucina mucocephala, so what's called Subabul, in that category. And the reason that there's a great deal of work which shows why these are invasives, because one looks at the ways in which they're able to spread at the expense of native species. So, for instance, in the case of Proserpis juliflora, it actually releases certain toxic alkaloids in its root zone that deter other species from growing. With the result that you find that it's a tree that literally drives out other native species. What I tried to indicate in my talk today was the way in which the idea of indigeneity is something that needs to be calibrated. Where foresters like Clutterbuck went wrong when they recommended trees for the Delhi Ridge was that they thought if they're recommending a tree from the moist plains of the Himalayan foothills of UP, because those trees are also indigenous, they will work in the context of the ridge. And that's clearly not the case, because even though they're indigenous trees, they're not adapted to those particular ecological habitats. So there's now a lot of work which is, you know, sort of being spearheaded by Pradeep Krishan that tries to look at the Aravallis as a particular sort of ecological unit, and then tries to, it's almost like a kind of forensic horticulture, where you try and, you know, do soil samples, you look at the pollen and so on, in order to try and recreate what the natural vegetation of the area would have been like, and then you try and plant appropriately for it. So, of course, it's nobody's conceit that they can go back to some sort of pure form of what the forest used to be like, but they're doing their best to make sure that the forests that they do plant or protect are at least ecologically suited, don't need extra irrigation, don't need any huge managerial interventions from the forest department and so on. So I think there's now a bit of sensitivity around the use of terms like indigenous, alien, invasive, exotic, and so on. And I think the conversation is far beyond that mode when, you know, these were sort of thought of as black and white categories. And for your second question about the way in which what I in my other work called bourgeois environmentalists interact with the state, I don't really have time to go into it at length just now. But, you know, if you're interested, I can certainly suggest a couple of things you might like to read on the subject. But one of the interesting, one of the characteristics of bourgeois environmentalism that I think is a defining feature of their work is the fact that they actually do operate through the courts. Unlike other environmental social movements where we see attempts to influence the executive, to take out protests that try and work with local politicians and so on, in the case of bourgeois environmentalism, sort of leapfrog over what they think of as an inherently corrupt process of dealing with politicians, and they go straight through the media to the courts. So it's a particular way of dealing with authority, making use of one's own, you know, class connections and the cultural capital networks that one has. And it's quite different from the way in which, say, poor people, when they act collectively to try and secure access to resources, mobilize and make use of different channels of the government. So there's a very distinct signature to the way in which bourgeois environmentalists deal with the state. And in some ways, it's a contradictory consciousness, because often they're the beneficiaries of the very kind of political processes that they, you know, that they're disdainful of engaging in.
You just mentioned something that I was going to ask about, and I'd like to talk a little bit more about the media and both television and newspapers and other media. Have they come down on one side or another? Are they influenced more by one group than the other? And have they moved this discussion forward with investigative reporting and things like that?
The media has actually been quite, the English language media at least, has been quite attentive to the issues of the encroachments of the ridge or the tree cutting in the Mangalwadi Sacred Grove and so on. And I think that's partly because the middle class conservation groups, the upper middle class conservation groups, are really well, they're very media savvy, and they know how to, you know, write precisely the right. I mean, partly they even manage to, they don't need the press, television or print media anymore. You know, they have their own websites. They're on Facebook, they're bombarding, you know, both government officials as well as the newspaper offices with their own video clips as well as press releases, photographs and so on. So the media has played a very, very important role in terms of not only helping these movements come into prominence, but also in creating that larger sensibility of Delhi as a city, where there are people who are, you know, being included in a conversation about these issues, and who therefore so slowly get socialized that, you know, these are issues we should be thinking about and caring about. This was not the case, say, in the 1980s when I was growing up. You know, no, the ridge was just the press didn't talk about the ridge. It was just this green, hilly area that was just there. Nobody cared about it. So the media has actually been critical in gradually developing an urban public that's defined by caring for its environment, in which the ridge is important. But earlier, these were not thought of as as collective issues of concern.
My interest is in land and law, my work is in land law. And I was really interested in the 30 to 40 year history that you gave us. There's a constant combination of law and executive orders that get used to expropriate land. And especially that every innovation and executive orders kind of supplants and undermines an act only to then be challenged, and then a new act comes in the province. And something that I think is happening in urban Mumbai is sort of total undermining of progressive land legislation with the repeal of the Land Ceiling Act
and the rent control, and
further innovations in land pooling through executive orders, or even just through not very well regulated, vaguely market-based transactions. So, in that context, what do you see as the potential for law as an instrument for weaker sections or poor to claim their rights? Protect their claims. And like you said, there's this footprint of the middle class bourgeois environmentalism on the PIL, which the poor are not able to replicate. So what potentials do you see? And are there examples of poor people using the law for their
benefit? I think things have really shifted against poor people using the law. From the time of the Olga Teles judgment, where squatters on the pavements of Mumbai could be, had their at least their rights to place and protected, so that they didn't have to be evicted. I think there's been a sea change since then. So I know Delhi best, and I know that for Delhi, there've been a series of judicial orders, the closure of factories, which meant that not only did people lose work, but also since many of these factories had housing for workers, workers lost housing as well. And even though the courts gave quite sort of paternalistic orders about one third of the land must be used to develop low-cost residential housing, one third must be set aside for public areas, one third can be developed commercially. And I suppose that's common, that's true of the Bombay textile mills lands as well. In fact, none of this was done. So what we've seen is a gradual either dilution or complete ignoring of those legislative orders which at least tried to offer something, some form of protection for slum dwellers or poor people in general. Or what we see, and I think this is much more common Delhi, is the use of environmental public interest litigation to evict squatters. And this is done in a completely, there are double standards here. So in the case, I've written about the Yamuna floodplain in Delhi, where poor squatters who have no legal housing made available to them get kicked out. But the Akshardham temple, the Commonwealth sports village, a couple of power plants, they're allowed to be there on the floodplain. They're not seen as an environmental violation, even though they are. So the person who's written about this is Asher Gardner, and his book came out, I think, a couple of years back. And he says that in the eyes of the law, if a thing looks good, And you know, he calls it rule by aesthetics, but the idea of aesthetics is linked to the you know, the sort of heavy duty capital invested in something. So building a shopping mall or a luxury hotel on the Delhi Ridge is okay, because you know, that's good, that's the kind of development we want. Whereas a squatter settlement has no business to be there. So the idea of environment and aesthetics are really closely fused together in a way that has nothing to do with sustainability. And I think the sort of hierarchy in the courts that we see, the pattern that we see in the court's orders with regard to a whole set of cases is, first, capital must be protected. Second, the environment, and by the environment I mean the bourgeois environmentalist version of the environment, so green areas, etc. And then poor people's concerns come last. And there's another book by Gautam Bhan which specifically looks at the law and how it's been used to act against squatters in Delhi, and the way in which, you know, their very presence is criminalized because the state is the reason why people can't afford legal housing. So they're criminalized by the failure of the state to provide housing, and then they get, you know, chucked out from where they have managed to invest something and build homes because, you know, they're people out of place because they're environmental, they violate environmental norms. This is something that Nikhil has also written about, and I think even for Hyderabad, if you look at the work of perhaps Anant Maringanti, I'm sure you know his work, yeah. So there are a number of people who have looked at that, and I think there's still a lot more that needs to be done. I wish I could say there's something changing about this, but I think interpretations of the law have really moved, and perhaps it's worth our while to look at why that's.
So I've got a question. So the Gujar communities that are selling their land, and then there's a sort of like shift in sides where they then go on to like engage in these bourgeois politics. Are they themselves, because I know a lot of communities actually make quite a bit of money from selling their land, are they themselves experiencing like a change in class identity or class aspirations that might also be playing a role in this?
Didn't really actually explore that very much, but I know from other people's studies, especially Mike Levian's very detailed work of in you know, these two villages on the outskirts of a special economic zone outside Jaipur, that has been the case, and that my impression from what I know of Mangar and Baliyawas and the, you know, these three villages in the area, is that most of the villagers who sold their land actually use the money then to buy land somewhere else. Not for cultivation, but speculation.
Yeah.
You know, expecting that they would gain off of it. From other villages in Delhi, we know that a lot of that money is spent on conspicuous consumption. So far more lavish weddings, you know, the groom arrives in a helicopter to the, you know, that's a sort of classic case, and so on. Yeah, it's very odd now because you see these large, you know, what used to be fairly modest rural homes now have big concrete walls and ornate, you know, wrought iron gates and so on. You still see women there though that are, you know, making those cowden cakes by hand. So you wonder, you know, they've got the money, but then they're not using that money to use cooking gas to fuel to cook with. Even though that would be so, make life completely different for women. So there is a lot of wealth, but in some ways I think social relations within the household haven't changed. They may well have, I mean, that's a question you're asking, right, about between villagers in terms of, you know, class differentiation and so on. But I don't see very many signs of that. I'd have to actually do much more detailed investigation into these issues to find out, but it's well worth checking. Yes?
Thank you for having me. So, I had a couple of questions. First, like as you mentioned, the name of the Gujar one. So, are is it also that they want to look at the space which are already been integrated and put into use, and whether they support basically reusable spaces in some manner? Like I was like, one thing was, I don't know, it didn't come by, it was getting the lead.
Yeah, I'm not sure what your second question is, in the sense that you're saying that that ecologically important areas get are used to settle poor people, and then later, that's been the case with, there's this term that came into Indian environmental management in, I think, the late 1980s. India developed, when India drafted a policy for national wastelands, national waste. So this was really quite, in retrospect, it seems to have been this incredibly important move that transformed the character of wetlands, grasslands, across the country, because the one central idea, strategy that the government had for quote-unquote reclaiming wastelands was to plant trees on them. And there was a lot of money available through social forestry projects funded by the World Bank and other international agencies to just plant trees. Even to this day, I mean, in India right now, there's concluded on October 2nd, there's been this Guru Jaggi Vasudev, who has led a so-called rally for rivers, where he plans to save all of India's rivers by planting trees on a 1 kilometer strip on each side of every river in India. So this sort of, this idea that planting trees is a magic bullet that's always environmentally benign, has been around since it's probably been around even longer, from colonial times, and the idea of, desiccationism and so on. But in India, it became ingrained in official policy from the time the word wasteland was coined. And so yes, around wastelands we've seen both the removal of poor people, the removal of the kind of flora that they might depend on for fuel, fiber, fodder, and the plantation of trees from which they are then, which local villagers are prohibited from using, from cutting and so on. It's also that a lot of this, interventions have been ecologically inappropriate because they fail to understand the dynamics, the ecological dynamics of those areas. So, for instance, habitats for grassland creatures like the great Indian mustard or for the Indian wolf have been destroyed because people have gone and planted trees like eucalyptus or in previous times acacia auriculiformis and So I think there's a fair amount of criticism of these sorts of managerial moves. I don't think it's yet resulted in any sort of concerted change in policy yet. So there are a number of things that one still has to work at to be able to change that. Meanwhile, I think you're quite right that when it comes to wetlands, especially in cities like like Hyderabad, Bangalore, and so on, where wetlands used to be a part of the city's water provisioning and so on, there's been this gradual move to fill them up, construct on them, first perhaps by series of small squatter settlements and so on, but then once that land filling happens, then squatters may get eliminated, the land built upon with more capital intensive ways, with of course the kinds of devastating results that we've seen in terms of flooding in Mumbai as well as Bangalore in the past. So yeah, but these are very large ecological processes, and I think the information about them is, we still have scattered sources of information. Somebody needs to put it all together to come up with a comprehensive way of understanding what's going on in terms of both the ecological transformations and how they fused with the social transformations in terms of rights of access, ownership, how people think about these areas.
Helpful to hear a talk and think together between Mahatma and the Delhi range. I think we need to follow a little bit on some of the conversation earlier. What was really interesting was the ways in which the environmentalists in both instances were able to call upon the protections of the forest department or call for forest protection. And as they do so, I'm thinking of the old new legacies of forest department work, right, and the critique of simplification for forest departments actually engaged on public landscapes. So here, would the generativity of their protections be the stuff the forest department does or have learned to do better? Or is it just that they preclude or prevent land from entering the commodity land markets? Speculative building that can see, which is to say that should this land be notified, the notification itself the aim or the main intervention, or is it stuff the forest department does after with the land to reinstitute a different kind of ecology in place?
Yeah. Your question is more sophisticated than what the Haryana Forest Department has actually shown on the ground. Their attitudes have been the majority attitude has been, if the chief minister wants to denotify this area as forest, that's fine with us, and he will make some money off of it. So they haven't really shown much commitment to even holding on to their territory. And in some ways, I used to find this surprising earlier, but for 2 years I served on this committee of the government called the Forest Advisory Committee, which is meant to review all projects that come up to the Ministry of Environment and Forest for that require the diversion of forest land. Diversion basically means you cut down all the trees and have a mine or a highway or a dam or whatever on that area that's controlled by the Forest Department. And what I found really startling in the beginning was that all of these projects came with the hearty approval and backing of the state forest departments. You would think that if nothing else, the forest department at least want to protect its turf and not give it over to mining companies, to power dam corporations and so on and so forth. But that wasn't the case. So in that sense, I think most of the forest department is pretty well integrated into the larger political economy of construction. At the same time, they also, by and large, genuinely believe that this is good. This is economic growth, this is progress, this is the kind of development that we want to see. So when they see the, sort of rugged, shrubby, degraded forests around Mangalbani, they don't see it as an area that, if protected, will result in the regeneration of the Aragami forest. They see it as wasteland and as land that that would be improved if it were made into something else. However, there are a few forest officers who are an exception to this rule. And in fact, one of them, who acted as a whistleblower and then was persecuted and pushed around and transferred from one place to the other, he's the guy I quote who talks about the political bureaucratic, nexus. So, by and large, I think the when one looks at the Forest Department in this case, this is so enmeshed in the in the price of land, which is due, the whole commodification drive is so strong that there's just no room for other sorts of debates in terms of thinking about, the quality of the forest, the character of the forest, the kind of state simplifications that you were talking about are operating at such a crude level that the only choices here seem to be, construction or something else. And the something else for most forest officers is not attractive enough, not worthy of protection. So it's pretty hopeless story. but mind you, there are these other these activists who try to, through the courts, are trying to get the Forest Department to say, this is what the law says. This is what you're supposed to be doing. So, they try to use the law and use the forest regulations, going back to the 1991. The famous Buddha Varman case that said that if any land has trees on it, it's forest. So they're trying to make use of those kinds of legal orders to protect the area and get the Forest Department to do what is supposed to be its job.
That's like a more hopeful note.
Constant vigilance.